This is Carolyn Gilbert in Texas, and our guest is Adam Bernstein of the Washington Post. We have spoken with Adam earlier in regard to his own obituary writer's career, and of course he is the obituary's editor, so he has a lot of responsibility along that line for the Washington Post. But at this point, we want to talk to Adam about someone from whom he learned a lot of his tricks of the trade, and I want him to talk a little bit about Richard Pearson, who was his predecessor in the role of the obituary's editor for the Washington Post. Adam, you may tell anything you want to.
Rich Pearson, who we're going to be talking about, loved obituaries because he just didn't have to deal with the bureaucracy of let's say the foreign desk or writing or you know, something you know, of that more obviously prestigious nature. He was a big Anglophile, so when he was editor, you'd have a lot of locals. You know, the people who are very famous, famous actors, actresses, and then a prominent British author every now and then. You know, and it was just that was sort of the chance to really do a fun, exciting job on a story for Rich Pearson. And his way of sort of, you know, going the extra mile. He loved being able to have total control over his own life, which you don't necessarily have on other beats. He liked the freedom that, you know, that obituaries afforded him. Like I discussed in the, you know, I learned, he cemented for me why I love the job too, about, you know, being able to have far more control over what goes in the section, more than any other section where everybody wants to have their say. So he was, you know, widely read on all kinds of subjects, espionage. He loved sports. And curiously enough, animal husbandry. He was a connoisseur of chickens.
And he was a 4-H member when he was a little boy, too. I remember that.
Exactly. He grew up on a farm, and he got... he got an award from the 4-H. I think he liked to describe it as his Pulitzer Prize.
Well, that's rich.
And I remember one day we had a the TV section in the Post had a picture of a chicken on it, and Noodle got furious. It described a certain kind of chicken, and Noodle was furious because he knew it wasn't that kind of chicken. It was a different kind of chicken, and they just put some generic bird on there that wasn't really what they were supposed to have had. So, I mean, he was incredibly adamant about details like that, getting those things right. So just working for him was fascinating on many levels. He was also really probably one of the smartest people I'd ever met. His knowledge of world affairs was equal to anybody's in the newsroom, mostly because he was in pretty poor health much of his life, and he had sleep apnea and would stay up basically much of the night reading. And so, you know, you turn something in about some obscure topic, whether it's on a mathematician or on a foreign service official or ambassador somewhere or potentate abroad, and he would say no, that's not right, I don't think so, and he'd invariably be correct.
I want you to tell, why was he called Noodle?
Well, he was about my height, which is maybe about 5'9" or so, and 300 something pounds. Just a very large guy, He was always large, I believe, and never particularly inclined to exercise at all at any stage in his life. And when he got to American University from his home state of Illinois, there was some kind of a physical fitness requirement then, and at college, and he was there was a wrestling coach who accused him of having the energy of wet noodles, and pro- And I got, his friends thought it was funny, and they just kept calling him Noodle. So he was.
So he stuck.
Very few people knew him as Richard. The people would say, "Oh, where's Noodle?" And if you'd say, "Where's Richard?" nobody would know what the hell you were talking
exactly.
about. For that alone, he was an unmistakable presence in the Post newsroom. He was fearless, and for whatever reason, and a mischief maker, pure mischief maker. And I can't quite figure out what allowed him to get away with it, other than the fact that probably no one else wanted to be obituaries editor, and he was particularly.
Yes.
I remember he put up. What did he do? Oh yes, he teased a top editor who had gone to. He didn't like heirs at all, and some top editor who had gone to Yale was, demanded total oversight of the obituary for Kingman Brewster when Kingman Brewster died. The former president of Yale, and Noodle had assigned it to a guy who happened to be on the desk and happened to have gone to Yale. And so he knew everything was going to be fine, but he just hated this other editor sticking his nose in the story, demanding to see the copy, wanting to, invariably have his say on the Yale president. And so what Noodle did was he turned in the story. The story was fine. He turned it into the copy desk for editing. And shortly before deadline, he walked over a copy to the offending editor, saying, "Sorry, it's taken so long. I think it's in pretty good shape, but just if you want to look through it, here you go." And he printed out a special copy of the story that was exactly what was going to go in the paper, except for one crucial detail: he had changed all the Yales to Harvard.
Oh no! Oh no!
So the guy in the had to print it back. But that was sort of the his way of revenge on people who would invariably stick their nose in what we do, and in teaching them a lesson, leave us alone or else you're going to get more of it.
When you mention his desk, having seen it when I attended the memorial service that the newspaper did for him, I saw his desk, and no wonder he knew everything, because every book in the world was stacked up on that desk.
Yeah, right near the big jars of cafeteria chili that he would keep. I mean, he could write things off the top of his head accurately. And he saved me. I remember it was one of my first days on the job when I was 23, and some Nixon era, high ranking economist died, and it played to my worst fears because, I was at the Post. I didn't want to screw up things too badly in my first position of some responsibility. And I had to write about a Nixon-era economist who was, a big deal in the 70s.
And there you were, 23.
I was 23 and happened to be the jerk who stayed late that night. And I just was paralyzed. And Noodle came back from home and wrote it fluently, perfectly within, half an hour or so. And it was just, I was dazzled by it. And I was grateful for him doing that. It was a rare, he understood my concern that I didn't want to, be the guy who embarrassed the section of the paper, ever since then, I've kept that in mind when I've had to mentor people. Ever since that, I want them to build their confidence slowly. If somebody like that died, they can handle it. And he was just a fabulous mentor to have in the long term. I do remember though that it was painful at first, because every writer, especially at that age, has certain writerly affectations that annoy the hell out of people who are a little bit more experienced. Choosing $25 words when a 5-cent one is just as good, an abundance of alliteration, all the things that you're always told as you're growing up are really creative, and really work against you as a journalist, because they're annoying. They get in the way of the story. And Noodle had a way of just slicing them out. And it was just like he had shot me through the heart every time he did it. It was very painful at the time, but I realized in retrospect why he did it.
Uh-huh.
And one learns very quickly what not to do when that is, when you care about your writing and somebody is, having that kind of an approach to editing. So he could be very tough as well. He was not always the most patient man. He would kind of erupt when challenged at times. But you just had to know when to get him in a very good mood. And you can usually diffuse it by a sense of humor. He didn't really have much. He didn't have any time for people who couldn't laugh at themselves. I always remember to, you know, in every given story, a friend of mine who's an editor, a very good editor, said that with noodle stories, you always knew that there was at least one joke in there. And there may very well have been many more, but at least one that made the story worth reading. And I've always kind of kept that in mind about what I admired about his writing, about Noodle's writing, that you're going to give the reader something to go home with, just as a quick, you know, a joke at the very least. So I rarely write a story, unless the person is a total drip, without trying to infuse it with some kind of humor.
He must have been a person whom others thought they could trust, and that's very important in obituary writing, of course.
That's true. I'm remembering little things about Noodle as we're talking about him. I remember he had a deep respect for teachers. He didn't much respect the Foreign Service, whom he once accused of. He accused the Foreign Service officers. I remember this caused a big stir at the time. You know, the Foreign Service, you know, filled with people whose greatest accomplishment is being able to order sweet and sour pork in 12 languages. And it gives you a sense of, you know, what he thought about people who are generally puffed up and have a reputation for wearing, Savile Row suits. And he just didn't like that. He was very low-key. He liked people who dedicated their lives to very difficult professions like teaching, very important professions. He was fascinated by, you know, British characters, the real eccentrics who, write dirty books about cricket and that sort of thing. He had a very definite sense of what people were worth writing about and what people were really not.
I'm sure.
For better or for worse. I mean, you know, he didn't... I wouldn't know if that's the best way to approach the Foreign Service. I mean, obviously, like any profession, some people are far more interesting and accomplished than others, but that's who he was as an editor, as a person. And when you worked with him, you totally respected where he was coming from.
You know, I remember the last time that I spoke with him, and the next time I heard from him, he sent me an email that said, I'm sorry that I've been so tardy, but I have a good excuse. And the next line was, I have pancreatic cancer. And so we spoke a couple of times after that on the phone, but I did ask his permission, you know, if I could call him, because he didn't like that either, really. But he said, of course, and then while he was gone by November, I think, of that year, late November, early December.
Noodle died in, November of 2003. Even though I worked with him for close to 4 years, he was out a lot of the time.
Is that right?
He was never in, you know, he was there when I first got there, but then gradually, increasingly, he was, from one ailment or another, it was very painful for him to work. I think he had carpal tunnel, he, you know, wasn't sleeping very well, he was, had one ailment after another. And so it's just, you know, life was very painful for him in many respects, and I think that also was why he, could have a flash, a flaring temper, and he also had, you know, strong opinions about a lot of things. Sure. But what's fascinating, though, is that something you pointed out, he really approached the devastating illness that he had with the characteristic humor that made him...
Exactly.
That made him great, you know, throughout his life. I never saw him after a while, but he, you know, I would call him and I would talk to him from the hospital room. He really didn't want a lot of visitors. And I remember he still had a great laugh. He had a full-bodied laugh. You can always tell when you had his interest. There's one story anybody interested in Rich Pearson has to read, and that's about a fellow named Bunny Allen. B-U-N-N-Y, like the rabbit, Allen, A-L-L-E-N, who Noodle called a great white hunter who became a legendary success in the pursuit of both big game and beautiful women. Courage, if not common sense, was something Mr. Allen seemed to have to spare. The story went on about how Allen was, romanced both Grace Kelly and Ava Gardner on the same movie set during the filming of Mogambo, and this being a time when Ava Gardner was still somewhat attached to Frank Sinatra, so yes. Noodle made the point of how it was awfully brave of him to
attempt. I agree with that.
The age of Frank Sinatra. So it's a great story that he did. I'd say that is certainly among the finest he ever wrote. And I would encourage, like you said, I would encourage people to look him up to see really fine, clear, fun writing. You know, the glory of obit writing to him was getting to travel in your head. You know, live vicariously.
Thank you for taking your time to talk about Rich Pearson and to contemplate your own writing, which I find very exhilarating. So thank you very much, and we'll say good evening.
Well, thank you very much, and I hope this is useful to people down the line.
Adam Corey Franklin here. I once asked Richard Pearson what he wanted on his own tombstone, and he said, half in jest, shot by a jealous husband. So I picked a song with that in mind. He told me he enjoyed this one.
Okay, very good.
Some more now. When he's out betraying, you hear people saying,